All right, Dr. Ed Park, we're fortunate to speak with Dr. Michael Fossel, MD, PhD from Stanford, who just gave some lectures on aging and Alzheimer's and gene therapy. Thanks, Dr. Fossel.
My pleasure. Good to see you.
Yeah, nice to meet you in person, in real life, as they say.
Is that really true? Every time I've been in touch, I never actually talked to you in person.
Right.
I didn't realize that.
Well, Skype is almost. Yeah. I feel like I've been in your sculpture garden. And anyway, so tell us in a nutshell. I did a blog recently about Alzheimer's and showing a graph, and it showed like 30 or 40 candidates, of which three or four made it through the FDA, of which they were just disease mitigating at a very low level. Yeah. So what's the problem with viewing Alzheimer's as a magic bullet single molecule disease?
The major problem as we approach Alzheimer's is that people have no model to date. So, for example, we have endless targets, starting with beta amyloid and everything associated with beta amyloid, tau proteins, and a number of other targets, none of which have ever been shown, if you do anything to beta amyloid, for example, have ever been shown to change the disease vector. We also don't have an overarching model that explains not only Alzheimer's, but Lewy body dementia, frontotemporal dementia, Parkinson's dementia, other dementias, vascular dementias. There are a whole category of age-related dementias, age-related CNS dysfunctions, that we have no understanding of as a group. We try to parse out little ones as though, you know, they're separate. But likewise, we have no model that encompasses animal problems. For example, you know, I have a 19-year-old cat, and I got to tell you, she's got Alzheimer's. I wouldn't call it that. But animals have cognitive decline like humans do, too. We have no model that encompasses all of that, that says, how is aging playing a role in age-related CNS dysfunction, including Alzheimer's? That's why we failed in all these trials. We are aiming at symptoms, biomarkers. We're not aiming at the cause of the disease.
Right. So you came up with the telomere theory of aging way back and articulated it beautifully in 96 and in subsequent life work. What if we take a cellular model and say, well, all these things that we're trying to call distinct diseases with distinct phenomena is really just wear and tear in the brain, degradation of neural stem cells and their supporting. How would it be if we just thought of it that way?
I wouldn't call it wear and tear, although it's pretty close. I mean, the real problem is not the wear and tear. It's the fact that we turn down the maintenance system. It's not entropy. It's not the collection of damage. It's the fact that you're turning down the repair mechanisms in the brain. But it does encompass all of those things. It begins to explain how, you know, Alzheimer's and Parkinson's and animal cognitive decline, all of those work, and more importantly, it offers you a better target for curing those diseases.
But what if we've been misconceiving, like, we look at the pathological phenomenon and we say, well, that must be a disease because it looks different, but what if we just say it's kind of like headache or a sore shoulder?
That's exactly it. You know, I'll give you an example. This would be like me trying to cure somebody with Ebola by giving them blood products and something for nausea and something for vomiting, something for diarrhea, something for fever. Those aren't the disease. Those are symptoms of the disease. And some of them are pretty important symptoms, like bleeding. But they're not the disease. The disease is the virus. The same thing is true here with Alzheimer's. You know, beta amyloid plaque is not the disease. It is an outcome of the disease, and it can be an important one. And tau tangles can, and a lot of other things can, mitochondrial dysfunction. But they aren't the disease. And if you're doing is treating symptoms, you're not going to prevent or cure the disease.
So let's say it's a loss of stem cell function, maybe exosome signaling. I just read an article today, as a matter of fact, that showed if you put old CNS cells on soft matrix, like they're saying actually the matrix in which the cells find themselves, influences their phenotype. So if you put them on a nice soft tissue instead of a hard old brain, they'll start acting younger. So what if it's just everything? The whole system is simultaneously eroding in terms of extracellular matrix, support cells, you know, gene silencing, you know, gene deletion. What if it's everything?
Well, I think that's not, you know, I would say that's not quite right. From my perspective, it's not, there's a way to unify all that. And the unifying change is this altered pattern of gene expression. You know, if I look at the genes in my brain, say at age 8, and my brain now say 68, and if I looked at the gene expression, what you see is a different pattern of gene expression. The genes are the same. The gene expression has altered its tune and its tempo. And the outcome of that is, for example, maintenance gets turned down. For example, the turnover rate of beta amyloid. goes down with age, but it's associated with a change in gene expression. It's not the genetics, it's the epigenetics. And that expresses itself in lots of ways. It expresses itself in the way my mitochondria function. It's expressed in the cells on blood vessels in my brain. It's expressed in those mitochondria, the DNA, the beta amyloid, the tau proteins. All of these things can be traced back to this altered pattern of gene expression. And the important thing to note, everything you mentioned can be, including the changes in neural stem cells. And all of those things can be reversed, including the neural stem cells. Mm. We've got data showing that if we use telomerase, we can reset neural stem cells so you get normal proliferation, normal differentiation, and regrowth the brain tissue.
Yeah.
No, it's a pattern of gene expression that can be reset.
There are some people at this conference who will be speaking tomorrow about exosome therapy, and they're claiming to have good anecdotal results treating advanced Alzheimer's. What do you think is the potential for exosomes to modulate gene expression, theoretically?
Well, exosomes are a tool, not a treatment in a sense.
Okay.
I mean, there's sort of a spectrum running from liposomes and targeted liposomes, little things of them as little bags of lipids. But you can attach protein targets and other kinds of targets to it to target particular cells. At the other extreme, you've got viral vectors, for example, adeno-associated virus, and others too, mm-hmm. lentiviruses and so forth, in the middle of the exosomes. Because this is a spectrum of possibility. In all cases, what you've got is little bags of life.
Mm-hmm.
And they are varying in their complexity and how they're made. These are made by viruses, these are made in the lab, the exosomes are made by my cells.
Mm-hmm.
But they're all basically little bags of life that have targeting molecules on the outside tell them where to go, and some very interesting molecules on the inside.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, which ones are good for what things? We know that using adeno-associated virus, we can reset the aging process in the cells in the brain. And I think we can do it easily in human beings too.
Yeah.
We're pretty sure that we could do it with things like targeted liposomes. You probably could do it with exosomes.
Yeah.
All those are possibilities.
Now let's talk about, so you went out into business and you're trying to get a company called Telocyte, T-E-L-O-C-Y-T-E, off the ground. And the purpose of that exactly is to transfect telomerase and cure severe advanced Alzheimer's. Now, how far along in your company building process have you come?
We have all the people we need internally. We have a scientific advisory board that's remarkable because everybody's involved with their feet on the ground, and you know, they're actively involved getting their hands dirty things. They run companies, and they actually do a lot of this research.
Yeah.
They're not just academics. So we've got all the people we need. We are ready to go to the FDA and ready to go to the what's called an animal toxicity study that you need the first 6 months, and then ready to go with the human trial. It's just a matter of making sure that our investors go from the we're committed to the here's cash.
Right, right. I mean, it makes sense. So in terms of like Alzheimer's, I mean, you could almost consider an orphan drug indication because so many people have tried and failed. Like, there's really nothing out there that works.
Everything has failed.
Yeah.
Every single attempt has failed.
Yeah.
And even the best have failed in ways that I predicted. For example, if you look at the solanezumab data from Eli Lilly, you know, this is what happens as you go downhill with Alzheimer's. And if you treat somebody with their aducanumab or solanezumab in those days, it moved out a little bit and then continued parallel. This step off was about 8 weeks. So that's like, you know, that's like me saying you've got Ebola, you'll be dead in 1 week, but I'll give you an extra 8 hours. Not an impressive finding, particularly when, as I say, after that little step off, things were exactly parallel.
Right.
So everybody died, everybody went down at the same rate after a slight step off. That's what we predicted should happen. If all you attack is beta amyloid, you shouldn't be able to get any further than that.
Yeah. So maybe for a cellular disease, we need a cellular cure.
I think so. I mean, I would say, you know, if we went back to trying to treat or prevent, say, bubonic plague in the Middle Ages, most of the treatments in Europe for bubonic plague were based on magic, with the assumption that it was a matter of curses, the devil, witchcraft, evil spirits. And I'm sorry, prayer is not the answer. I wish everybody luck, but it's ineffective. What you needed was, for example, an antibiotic for bubonic plague, or an immunization for smallpox, and so on, the kind of treatments that could work. And what I'm seeing is people trying one after another of small molecular magic that's ineffective. It, to me, is no more effective than prayer in the Middle Ages.
Mm.
Nothing particular against prayer, but it doesn't work for bubonic plague.
Yeah. Well, okay, there you have it from Dr. Michael Fossel.
My pleasure.
At the cutting edge of trying to cure one of mankind's greatest tragedies. Thanks, Doc.
Thanks, Ed. Okay. Pleasure.